Our riches and our numbers burden the world.
If you remember the dramatic pictures taken by the Apollo fires on the Earth, standing out in space all by itself, no one after seeing that could deny that the world is finite. Then it's impossible for people to go on saying we have an infinite supply of air, an infinite supply of water, and an infinite supply of minerals. Man must learn to balance his activities in nature against the regenerative power of nature, or he is inevitably going to join the Tyrannosaurus in extinction.
As we grow richer, there is rising concern about pollution, our ability to feed a growing population, and fears that we may run out of fuel and metal.
A computer at the Massachusetts Institute of Technology has been used to look at these problems, to analyze in broad terms the direction in which our world is headed.
The most important lesson is that we're near the end of our development of society. You know, we've been going on for about 2,000 years, and we've reached levels of prosperity which carry the seeds of disruption and necessitate a complete re-look at the whole world, social, political, and other situations.
Killing us. Telling us that the world is in a completely unstable situation and is likely to fall to pieces if it doesn't stop growing.
Let's put it bluntly. Our option is not between this kind of society, present society, and a stable state society. It is between a stable state society and chaos.
The world is 6 billion years old. That is unimaginable. So think of it as a week. All through Sunday and most of Monday, nothing much happens. Late Monday night, a cell arrives. Life has begun. Through Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, and most of Saturday, life becomes more complex and more beautiful. In a barren universe, life on Earth is being sustained by an increasingly stable and complex biology. At tea time on Saturday, it is the age of the reptile. At 3 minutes to midnight, mammoth grow. One second before midnight, man the hunter becomes man the farmer. At 1/40 of a second to midnight, the Industrial Revolution begins. We'll be right back.
In that last 40th of a second, we have started to get richer at an ever-increasing rate. Growth is explosive. Population now doubles in 30 years. Man now uses twice as much energy as he did 15 years ago. And industrial production has nearly trebled in the last 50 years.
During this program, men on the Earth will consume 200,000 tons of petroleum and 200,000 tons of coal, produce 2,000 motor cars, and use 400 million kilowatts of electricity.
If we use known stocks at present rates, there will be no copper left in 2008, no zinc in 1995, no tin in 1989, and no mercury in 1985. There will be no silver, without which we cannot make films, in 1987.
Today we consume more than yesterday. Our children, if they live as we do, will use our resources more than twice as fast as we do.
Our grandchildren might need twice as much oil as we found in Alaska just to meet their increased needs for 1 year.
Such growth threatens to use up all the resources the Earth has to offer us. Such are the enormous needs of the industrial society of progress.
The industrial revolution has consumed vast quantities of fossil fuels, for example, and now there aren't many left. And it's as simple as that. If you have a kind of society which is going to eat the very planet you're on, eat it up, consume it, you will find that there's nothing left.
Our industry, the way we make things, attacks the fabric and stability of nature, the ecosystem, on which all life, including man, depends.
It has been developed to exploit the ecosystem without taking into account its continued existence. And our new technologies tend to disrupt ecological cycles, to break them, to intrude harmful, unnatural materials upon them. And therefore it can destroy the base of its own existence. Because of that, we are on a suicidal course.
We are faced by dilemmas. So great is our progress that it may push the Earth to its limits and beyond. We threaten a confrontation with nature. Progress to that confrontation is speeding up.
What we're really being told is that although nobody knows for sure exactly when it will happen or exactly what risk is the greatest risk man faces, scientists are fairly unanimous in saying that man does face extremely important risks.
global population is doubling every 33 years, when resource consumption is doubling every 20 years, no long-term view of mankind will proceed without first forming some preliminary answers to these questions.
The man-made world consists of a whole complex of such relationships like that. Change one thing, and it sets up a slow and complicated chain reaction.
The equations in the computer define these relationships, so the computer can show how one thing affects everything else, not only immediately, but over many years.
But first they ran the computer to see what direction the world would take if it ran its present course.
As the century unfolds, industry grows, as does food production, population. But we're using up all our raw materials, the limited metals and fuel in the earth. These run out. Without fuel and metals for the factories, industry collapses. Farming has become highly mechanized, and without petrol and electricity, food production falls too. There's no food and massive unemployment. So the population falls. People are dying.
When essential raw materials like oil and copper run out, civilized life ends.
If we go on as we are, society collapses because we run out of metals and fuel. Growth is halted by a resource crisis.
So they ran the computer to see what would happen if we solved the resources problem that caused the crisis in the first place.
This time, natural resources used carefully run down slowly. But industry continues to grow. This industrial growth produces a serious pollution problem. Pollution attacks both people and plants. Crops cannot grow, and farming starts to fail.
But now pollution is permitted to rise because industrialization goes further, and finally pollution begins to impair the lifetime of the people and the productivity of the agricultural sector.
To keep growing, we need more raw materials. If we find those materials, growth continues till we die of pollution.
So in the next run, they assumed not only that we had solved our raw materials, but that we had controlled pollution as well.
So resources still run down slowly. Industry can expand. Pollution, now controlled, doesn't become a problem. Growth is progressing. But this time, the population grows so large that food becomes a problem. Food production cannot keep pace with population. People starve. Industrial society collapses.
But as the population grows, food becomes more and more expensive.
doubles every 30 years, but adds 70 million extra human beings to the planet every year.
Population is stabilizing. Only 2 children per family. Industrial production and food production surge ahead. And pollution rises too. The system is growing. And again, industry uses too many resources, which run out. Bringing down the system yet again. Even with population control, growth brings us up against a resources problem.
However they juggled population control with pollution control, with resource conservation, with food production, the result was a breakdown. A breakdown that implies millions of deaths and the collapse of civilized life. Technical solutions are not sufficient.
Run illustrates very succinctly that pollution, natural resource depletion are not problems themselves. The problem is growth in a finite world. So long as we ignore that fact and rely on growth over the short term to solve our problems, overshoot and collapse of the form which we see in the world model seems to us to be absolutely inevitable.
Nature is balance. Tamper with one part of it, and the complex and unexpected will turn up in another part. That is what the study showed.
The model is simple. The world is complex. The crude predictions we see in the study will appear in the world in much more complex ways. The real event, if it happened, would certainly be more complicated.
Different ways, in various societies. The United States might conceivably have a natural resource problem, while Japan could conceivably fail to cure its pollution problems and be led into difficulty that way.
I wouldn't go so far as to say that the troubles we see are part of this business of an overloaded society that doesn't know how to conduct itself any longer.
Is there evidence that the base forces shown in the model are already at work in the world today? Some would say so.
Many, many millions of people already starve to death in the world. Pollution is killing people, but not very many. The health of a large number of urban dwellers is being increased because of environmental deterioration.
A report from the World Bank reads,
what are we to say of a world in which millions of people are faced with day-to-day deprivations that degrade human dignity to levels which no statistics can adequately describe?
Our wants grow more and more keen, and our complaints more bitter in all mouths. In every deed, pestilence, famine, and wars have to be regarded as a remedy for nations, as a means of pruning the luxuriance of the human race.
Those words were an eyewitness report made during the decline of the Roman Empire.
The Dark Ages followed. If this study is right, then our society is threatened. No one knows when or how. But if it does mirror the world, if we can see in our problems the stresses of growth, then the world is unstable. Growth, it seems, has an awful logic.
It is so obvious. In a way, it's so simple to consider that we cannot continually and exponentially go as we are doing now. Nothing in the world, nothing in life goes continuously.